Actually, you have a conventional definition about the viruses. The viruses are not cells. It's a big difference compared to the bacteria or other microorganisms. They are not cells, but they do need a cell to replicate. So a virus could be defined as a replicating organism, the first item. The second item is a virus must have just one nucleic acid, either the ribonucleic acid or the desoxyribonucleic acid. So you have two sorts of viruses. And the conventional in the conventional definition, the people say the virus have no function for the cells. And very often you speak about infected cell, because the virus must infect a cell or enter the cell. And it's wrong, because now we know many viruses have some functions, and very important functions, for the cells infected by the virus. So now the definition of the virus is changing a lot. That's why I'm here in the sand, because for a decade the scientists discovered the good viruses, or the friendly viruses, which has good functions for the cell infected by a virus. And for me, the best definition of a virus is information passing through a cell. Because when a virus gets inside a cell, the virus disappears. It is called the eclipse. Once the virus crosses the membrane of the cell and reach the cytoplasm, the virus disintegrates. You have some compounds, a bit of nucleic acid, but the structure of the virus disappears. And then the virus starts to replicate, and reach times, thousands of times, and to give a progeny. But this progeny is different. The progeny of viruses, millions of viruses, thousands of viruses getting out of the cell, are made with new stuff, new atoms, new quarks, if you want. That's why now the scientists prefer to use this definition: virus is information. Yes, the process, the viral process, I mean the replication and the assembly of the virus and the exit of the virus, all these steps are very well known. But this dissolution of the virus, yes, it makes scientists put their minds about the true nature of the virus. Because once the virus is in the cell, you have a sort of checkpoint. The goal, if I may, the goal of a virus is to replicate, whatever the future, the fate of the cell. And in 100% of the cases, the cell will die. So first, the virus dissolves, and further, the cell will disintegrate. So you have two dissolutions: the dissolution of the virus, to give a new progeny, and the disintegration of the cells. That's why now some scientists prefer to speak about the virus by using the word the viral cell, because a virus has no metabolism. The cell has a metabolism, but the virus has not. That's why once the virus enters the cell, the program of the cell is completely different, because the cell infected by a virus, with the virus, the cell is not a cell anymore. It's a virus. So it's a breakthrough in the definition of a virus. So the virus could be defined by the particle which enters the cell, and the cell infected or full of viruses. You could make the comparison with the physics, with a particle and the wave. A virus is information, and a particle as well. But the virus is more. It's a cell full of particles, full of the progeny, ready to bring the information to other cells. It's completely different from a cell, because when a cell divides in two cells, then three, four, etc., you have the same component between the two cells. In a virus, it's different because you have this primary dissolution. So you could say, for a virus, it must die to live again, to live again. It's a new concept. So you could say, yes, to live, you have to die. Actually, the medium is a genome, because as the cell has a genome, the virus has its proper genome. It's either ribonucleic acid or desoxyribonucleic acid. And this genome is a source of information. And you could say our genome is also a sort of information, but it's different because the virus has to dissolve to create thousands of particles. Yes, but to summarize, you could say the information is is a genome, the genome of the virus, which is much smaller than the cell genome. To do a comparison, the size of the human genome is a billion of subunits called the nucleotides. In a virus, is several thousand, so it's much, much smaller. But
they all dissolve.
Actually, which dissolves is not the genome, it's the structure of the virus. And the structure of a virus is a capsid. The capsid is a shell which protects the genome. This part of the virus dissolves, but not the genome. The genome never disappears, except if the virus is killed outside the cell. Yes, in this condition, the capsid will disintegrate, and the genome, yes, is very fragile. But in a cell, it's different. The cell protects the virus somehow.
So the new home of the genome is the cell?
Yes, absolutely. Because a virus do need a cell, not only to protect the virus, but also to replicate and to do a progeny of thousands of particles, all identical. All the progeny is made with identical particle. I mean identical regarding the genome and this structure of the shell called the capsid. Actually, in the classical definition, and it's true for most of the virus kills the cell. After an infection or after the virus gets inside the cell, you have no cell anymore. The cell disintegrates. Okay, it's true when you consider one cell, but you never have one cell. You have a tissue with thousands of cells. So imagine a virus infecting this tissue. The virus start to infect one cell. You have the progeny, which is passed on to other cells, and 10 cells will be disintegrated. But at some stage, you have a checkpoint because you have the immune system which protects the host. It's the first checkpoint regarding the cell or the tissue. But you have also another checkpoint because some viruses has advantage to survive. If they kill the cells, they kill themselves. So some viruses have tricks to survive. So they change the program. They keep the cell alive or the tissue alive. And this property shows the intelligence of some of these viruses. Okay, it's the first case. You have a second case of the virus, and it's a case for the HIV or related viruses called the retroviruses. This, in a first step, these viruses kill the cells. You have a progeny, and at the tissue level, the genome of this virus is integrated in the chromosome and it's mandatory for this sort of virus to integrate the chromosome, the human chromosome, for example, for the HIV or the human retrovirus. And it's mandatory because once integrated, you have another step called the transcription of the virus to express all the compounds of the virus. But once the virus is integrated, it remains. It remains integrated, and it could remain integrated in safe cells, because this virus has a possibility also to preserve the cells. So you have two programs, a killing program, but also a safety program, because the virus has interest to survive. And in this case, and it's a case of the retrovirus, this virus has a very funny property, because the virus code for fusion protein. It's very, very, very important protein, because these proteins have the properties to merge the cells with each other. So imagine you have one cell infected by a retrovirus and another cell close by but not infected. When this cell is infected, you have this fusion protein expressed at the periphery. And one when this cell touch the other cell, they merge. So they create a bizarre cell with two nuclei, and so on, two nuclei. If you have a third cell, you have three nuclei, and so on. And this new cell is called a syncytium. A syncytium is a giant cell with many nuclei, and it's a trick for the virus to be out of control regarding the immunity. And along the time, the host could die, but sometimes the virus is able to infect the germinal cells, the ovary cells for the female, or the cells of the testicle for the male. And when these cells are infected by this virus, the virus is transmitted to the progeny, to the progeny of the male and the female. So you have this transmission to another generation of host. And stage by stage, the virus is tamed. It is called, and it's the beginning of the symbiosis for this retrovirus. So it's a new area, a new era starts from this point. Because once the virus is transmitted, it behaves like a gene. The integrated genome of the retrovirus behave like a gene. That's why millions of years after, you could have new function. And it's the case for some retrovirus called human endogenous retrovirus W, which creates the placenta in the mammals. So it's a property transmitted by a very, very old infection by this retrovirus called HERVW. Certainly this virus infected our ancestors, maybe the monkey or even before. And we kept this property, which is very important for the female to do the placenta. It's a property coming from a virus. So it's a breakthrough. It's quite recent, which is spectacular, is at the stage of the primary infection is at random. By chance, by any chance, a host will be infected by this retrovirus. And over time, I mean, for thousands of years or millions of years, the host keeps the memory of the virus. Actually, they are the survivors of this first epidemic, which keep this information. And eventually, the host finds, yes, gosh, this protein is able to fuse the cells, to merge the cells. Yes, maybe we could exploit this new property. That's why this property of doing the placenta appeared over time, millions of years after this first epidemics. Actually, this story about the placenta showed how a viral protein metamorphosed into a host protein, which has exceptional property, the property to do the placenta. And the same phenomenon is known for other viruses, not for retroviruses, but for all for other viruses. But the basic property is the same, because this envelope of protein having this fusion property could be kept by the host to fuse cells, but not for the placenta, to do the bones or the muscles or some organs in the vertebrates and in the mammals. You have very recent studies showing the similarity of envelopes of virus, rubella virus, tick-borne encephalitis virus, the similarity of this envelope and this fusion protein, which we are known to be human, but they are not human. They come from a virus which has infected the host million years before. Actually, certainly many, but only so far only two or three they are very well known functions. The only proteins so far are the sensitin, the protein which makes the sensitive trophoblast in the placenta, and this protein called EFF1, which is involved in the fusion process in the bones of all the mammals, the heart, etc. So you have very few examples, but it's the starting point of a new era to understand why the virus, actually, which are not cells, but they create new cells and new form of life or new form of function in the living beings. Yes, we have more bacteria in the gut than human cells. It's 10 to the 15 bacteria compared to 10 to the 14 cells. And imagine in our genome, 10% of the genome is made with virus. We have this endogenous retrovirus inside our genome, 10%. And we have also bits of virus, because through evolution, we got rid of some bits which are useless. So you could say 50% of the human genome are made with proper viruses and bits of viruses. And only 2% are coding sequence, coding for human proteins. The rest is either complete viruses, incomplete, and the rest is unknown. You have a sort of black box in the human genome. And in whatever genome, for the monkey is the same, or for many mammals, you have the same structure. Very, very tiny part, which is coding. You have the part of the virus embedded in the genome, and the rest, which nobody knows exactly the functions. So, certainly these bits of the genomes code for regulation properties, but so far nobody knows the function of this black box. Actually, the viruses are not only our ancestors, but they through evolution, they created new properties. sort of quantum leaps in the evolution, because you know you have the theory of Darwin with the mutation, the selection. It's valid, it's still valid, but for many years the scientists didn't understand this jump in the evolution and why the placenta is made with this giant cell called the syncytiotrophoblast. But no, we have the explanation. So yes, the virus make us human. They help make us human. You could say that. Yes, now you have this crossing between the biology and physics, for example. It's very important for the biologists to speak with physicists, because through the physics you can reach the structure of the living matter, the structure of the nucleic acids, since Watson and Crick, it was in 1953. But now you have access at the structure of whatever proteins. And not only the structure of the protein, but now you have, through the physics, you have access at the structure of the macro complex, the complex between several proteins, and complex between proteins and nucleic acids, for example, in the ribosome, which is a machinery to do the protein. Yes, it's through the physics you have access to the structure. And understanding the structure is very important in many areas, for medical purpose, to do new drugs, or to understand how this complex operate. So yes, it's important for the biologists to work together with the physicist, and also with the mathematician, because now, you know, we succeeded to get the complete sequence of the human genome and whatever genome. And that's why now we know you have this little bit of coding sequences, the viruses embedded, and the pseudoviruses embedded, and this black box. We know that through the human sequencing. But now the goal is to compare the sequence. It is called the computational biology. So we do need the mathematics to compare the sequences and to have access at the function of these unknown sequences in the human genome and whatever genome. Actually, when you see the structure of the viral particle, you have two sorts of shells, because I told you the genome of the virus is protected by the shell, which is called the capsid, and you have two in the nature. You have only two sorts of capsid: the icosahedral capsid and the helicoidal capsid. In the case of the icosahedral capsid, the virus has a shape of an icosahedron, which is a perfectly symmetrical, and the shape is according to the golden ratio. And it's very useful for a virus to have this shape, this perfect shape, because when the virus is made inside a cell, you have a self-assembly of all the subunits. So for the virus to immediately get the right structure, it's fantastic for him because it's easy, it's compact, and it's very actually it for the virus it takes not a lot of energy to assembly. And the other structure is the helix, which is a perfect helix with like the shell of the snail, or the shape of the typhoon. And you have only that, the icosahedron, which is one of the solids of Plato, and the helix. You have only that. But it's beautiful. When you see the structure of the capsid of the adenovirus, it's beautiful. So now we have access to this shape through the physics. Yes, it's the ultimate question. Many times I said to myself, yes, this virus must be very intelligent. It's the case for the first sort of virus we spoke about a couple minutes before. It's the case of the Epstein-Barr virus. The Epstein-Barr virus, called EBV, is a member of the herpes viridae family. It's a DNA virus, and this virus co-evolved with a host through evolution. So you have ancestors of the EBV in the rabbit, and then when this animal evolved to another animal, then to the monkey, to the primates, and to human, this virus co-evolved. So you have a long, long time of evolution lasting millions of years when this virus, knows our body much more. We know our body because it evolved through times. And everybody is infected by this virus. 95-99% of the human population is infected by this virus. And this virus infects the lymphocytes, which is the core cells of immunity. So not only this virus evolved, and not only this virus know our body, but he knows the immune system. So for me, this virus is a sort of intelligence. And so far, very little is known about its role. But we kept this virus as an episomic DNA stick to the chromosome. So it's a bizarre gene because this virus is outside the chromosome. It's circular but sticks to the chromosome, and it replicates in a synchronic way as the cell divides. So this virus is somehow immortal. For me, this virus is very intelligent because he found the clue of immortality. So yes, you could say the virus have an intelligence. Not only they create the life, but they have this fragrance of immortality. I don't dare eternity. It's so creative. First, it's random. But at some stage, you have a checkpoint. Yes, here we are. What could I do with that? And a new function, a new new sorts of living appears, rise from this random event. You know, it's like, I read at some stage a planet hit the Earth and the Moon and the Earth fell apart, and it was completely random, and it's the same with apparently some molecules of water was brought through a meteorite. It's completely random events. So it's the same with the virus. It's a series of random events, but at the end, you have something magical appearing. It's an intelligence, sure, and certainly after, let's speak about the viruses again. When the virus enters, okay, it's random. The virus makes its job. But at some stage, you have a checkpoint and a decision making. For me, the ultimate question, who does this checkpoint? The cell, the host, or the virus? Who takes the decision? Is it the host, the cell, us, or this tiny particle called the virus? For me, it's the ultimate question. For me, which is mysterious in the virus, is the fact to create, you have to die. Because when a virus enters a cell, the first entity which dies is a virus. I told you, you have this dissolution. And then very quickly, it takes 1 minute, you have this new generation. It's the first death, the death of the virus. And then you have the death of the cell. And then you have the survivors, which creates something new. It takes time. It's not 1 minute. It can take years, hundreds of years. But first you have to die to create. For me, it's a big lesson of the viruses. So yes, the virus is our lover. It's certainly very dangerous lovers. But over time, you can contemplate the more than the strength of this love, this huge potentiality of the first love, but you have to die for that. Here you have some drawings with the charcoal and clay showing the life cycle of a virus. So here it's the viral particle infecting a cell with a nucleus here. So you have first the step of entering the cell, and you have this shade showing the virus is an information. Once inside a cell, the virus will replicate, and in this case the virus could replicate in the nucleus, and at this stage it is called a viral cell, because the cell changed its program. And it's a program of death, because after that, the cell will disintegrate. So at this at this stage, the cell has a metabolism. But once the virus is inside, it's completely different. And after that, the cell disintegrates. But sometimes you have a checkpoint, and the virus is so intelligent, it could reverse the program to save the cell, and even not only the save the cell is kept alive, but the virus survive. So it's a good metaphor for us to understand the way of a virus to be immortal. And after that, once the virus is inside the cell could have the virus replicating in a synchron way with the mitosis of the cell. So it's a very, very good way for us to understand this message, actually to create something, we have to die, the cell must die.